everybody. I am Dr. Aya Mohammed Fattouh, Professor of Pediatrics and Pediatric Cardiology, Cairo University. Today, we are talking about the approach to congenital cyanotic heart disease. I know it may be a kind of tough subject to most of those who are working in the field of pediatric cardiology because of the very wide variation in this topic. Today, we are going to talk about the approach of congenital cyanotic heart disease. I know it's a little bit tough subject to most of those working in the field of pediatric cardiology, but we are trying to make a simplified approach how to deal with such patients presenting with congenital cyanotic heart disease. Our objectives will be to have a classification or a categorization of the congenital cyanotic heart disease, a practical approach to those presenting with critical illness due to congenital cyanotic heart disease, and an outline about the management of these problems. Congenital heart disease could be presented with a wide variation of presentation, maybe with congenital with the congestive heart failure, cyanosis, which we are focusing today, decreased cardiac output and shock, murmur, respiratory distress and tachypnea, dysrhythmias, or simply to find an abnormality with the chest X-ray about the location or size of the heart. So to start with, what's cyanosis? It is a bluish discoloration of the skin and mucous membranes due to presence of more than 5 g/dL reduced hemoglobin. The first question to answer, is it central or peripheral? How to differentiate? The peripheral cyanosis is mostly in the extremities. It's never affecting the mucous membranes and the tongue. And if we measure the oxygen saturation, we will find it normal. While the central cyanosis affects the mucous membranes, the oxygen saturation will be decreased, and it's a serious condition. If we settle that it is central cyanosis, we have to search for the cause. And remember ABC. It could be due to airway obstruction, for example, in the neonates born with coronal atresia or laryngomalacia, micrognathia, or due to breathing problem like parenchymal lung problems, pneumonia, congenital diaphragmatic hernia, or due to cardiovascular problem, and on the top is congenital heart disease, or others like abnormalities in hemoglobin, or the so famous condition, persistent pulmonary hypertension of the newborn. And lastly, but not least, is the CN causes, which might cause respiratory depression and cyanosis. After we find it is central cyanosis, the most difficult point in the practice of neonatologists and pediatric cardiologists to know if this is a pulmonary or cardiac cyanosis. It's very important to take detailed history and do thorough examination, and there is no problem to get help with simple diagnostic tools. Pulmonary causes will have respiratory distress, but cardiac causes maybe or maybe not. Chest causes in general will present at birth if there is a problem with this neonate, while the cardiac manifestation maybe late first hours, first days, first weeks, and maybe more. The chest X-ray will find a pulmonary cause. The cardiac causes maybe the chest X-ray give us a clue or not. ECG is not of great value if we are dealing with a neonate, but maybe of help later on. And of course, we have other tools which we will talk about. Congenital cyanotic heart disease form about a quarter of the congenital heart problems, and the most common presentation focuses on cyanosis, congestive heart failure, shock, or arrhythmias. We have different approaches, but the most practical approaches are the age-oriented and the physiological diagnosis. My job, if I am facing a child or a neonate with cyanosis secondary to congenital cyanotic heart disease, is not to reach the exact anatomical variation, but to help this child to pass the critical period, if I am seeing him in a critical condition, and to plan the forehead management for this child. So we have two major approaches, which are age-oriented or physiological diagnosis. The age-oriented classifies them according to the age of presentation, whether he is presenting to me in the neonatal period, or early or late infancy, or in the childhood. On the other hand, the physiological diagnosis depends on the functional effect of this congenital anomaly on the blood flow, on presence of cyanosis, pulmonary blood flow, congestive heart failure, or appearance of shock. It's also important to assess the need for early intervention. Maybe this is a critically ill neonate who needs an urgent intervention to bypass this critical period. So if you are thinking about the age-oriented approach, we should think, when does cyanosis appear? If it appears during the neonatal period, so we could think about transposition of the great arteries, tricuspid atresia, total anomalous pulmonary venous return, abnormality, especially if it is obstructed, truncus arteriosus, severe form of fallot, Epstein anomalous pulmonary atresia. If it appears during the first week, so it could be tricuspid atresia, pulmonary atresia, or also TGA. If it appears later, we should think about tetralogy of Fallot, transposition of the great arteries, or total anomalous pulmonary venous drainage, but not the obstructed type. What determines this? We will talk about it later. So if it presents in an older age group, we should think about more details, like if this cyanosis associated with decreased pulmonary blood flow, we will put TOF and pulmonary atresia on top, or other non-TOF conditions with pulmonary stenosis or Epstein anomaly. We should think about cases like Eisenmenger syndrome, or we should think if there is cyanotic heart disease with increased pulmonary blood flow, that it could be an obstructed total anomalous. Or if there is cyanotic heart disease with normal pulmonary blood flow, there are other much less common conditions like pulmonary AV fistula. The pattern of cyanosis. If we have intermittent cyanosis, this might happen in conditions like Epstein anomaly. If it is a uniform cyanosis, so we are thinking about problems with right to left shunt on whatever level, either through ASD, VSD, or PDA. If it is differential cyanosis, which means that there is difference in saturation between the upper and lower limb, sometimes it is just differential cyanosis, which happens with severe pulmonary hypertension with normally related great vessels, like those with persistent pulmonary hypertension in the newborn, for example, or those with right to left shunt through the PDA. Sometimes there is a reverse differential cyanosis with saturation in the lower limb more than the upper limb, and this might be faced in cases with transposition of the great arteries with severe pulmonary hypertension. So after we thought about the age orientation, and you are facing a neonate presenting with cyanosis, which you find it's possibly a congenital cyanotic heart disease, and you want to make sure. Now, this is a universal approach that no newborn leave the nursery or the well-being baby nursery without doing a pulse oximeter screening. If his saturation is more than 95%, so he can go home, it's better to do this after 24 hours or earlier if the baby is going home anyway. If we find it less than 94% and there is difference between the upper and lower limb more than 3%, we should repeat it in another 1 hour if If not well, we will repeat after another 1 hour. If not improved, we should search for the cause. If it is from the start less than 90%, or there is difference more than 33% between the upper and lower limb, so this neonate didn't pass the screening and should be investigated. If you find that the PO2 is less than 70, so you are facing most probably a congenital cyanotic heart disease. If you find that it is more than 100 or 200, so it's most probably a pulmonary cause of central cyanosis. You can use also the EBG. It will help you to assess the CO2. If it is increased, it's most probably it is a pulmonary or CNS cause. While in cases of severe hypoxemia, you will find acidosis with low pH. This might happen also with sepsis, for example. It helps you to measure the PO2 accurately. Don't forget the history. Basic is basic. So the history can give you a lot of information. You should ask about the perinatal and gestational history. What about the mother? Did she take any medication, exposed to infection? Family history, is there other babies with congenital heart disease, hereditary diseases? Postnatal history. If you see the baby after he is discharged for home or after 1 month, for example, you should ask in details about the birth weight, the feeding habits, the increase in weight, presence or attacks of cyanosis. If he is an older child, you should ask about the possibility of chest pain, palpitations, history of syncope. All these informations are very important and can give you a clue what are you dealing with. Physical examination, don't forget the general examination, the appearance of the baby, cyanosed, dusky, polycythemic, the growth, the overall building of his body belt, presence of cyanosis and clubbing, tachypnea, respiratory distress, his weight, his height. Don't forget to measure the blood pressure in the four limbs. Don't forget to assess the femoral pulses. All these data can give you a clue what you are dealing with. The cardiac examination, inspection and palpation, check where is your apex, if there is any signs of ventricular enlargement, if there is palpable thrill or palpable sounds, auscultation to assess the heart sounds, to assess the presence of murmur. And when we are talking about murmur, you should assess the very important points about the location, radiation, the grade of murmur, associated thrill, associated symptoms. You have to differentiate between pathological and non-pathological murmurs. And remember that any murmur more than 3, any diastolic or continuous murmur, any murmur associated with other symptoms are not an innocent murmur. And you need to investigate children with these types of murmurs. Check his chest x-ray or any associated symptoms. This is a rapid diagram to give you a clue what can you do with it if you are seeing a baby or a neonate with a cardiac murmur. The most important, you should assess if there is cyanosis or not. You should assess the associated symptoms. You should feel his femoral pulses. If the murmur continues after 72 hours and there is any sign which I have said now, so you should refer him for further investigation. So our purpose is clinical recognition. You are not requested to do the exact anatomical diagnosis. You are requested to reach to a professional diagnosis with functional assessment of this child. You are not requested to know whether he is TGA with pulmonary stenosis and with persistent LSVC or more complicated anomalies. But you should know if there is increased pulmonary blood flow, decreased pulmonary blood flow, or associated pulmonary hypertension. You should know if this child needs urgent intervention or not. you should narrow your differential diagnosis to a group using history, physical examination, chest x-ray, ECG, pulse oximetry, hyperoxia test. All these tools will help you to narrow your provisional diagnosis and plan what you are going to do for this child. You have a variety of diagnostic tools. Chest x-ray is very important. Sometimes we are facing some doctors or pediatricians asking, referring the child for echocardiography, even without doing chest x-ray or performing a complete physical examination. But the chest x-ray is very, very important. It can give you a clue about the presence of cardiomegaly, the situs of this patient, the pulmonary vasculature, if there is increased or decreased pulmonary blood flow, and about the lung parenchyma, if there is associated pneumonia, for example. Here we can see this is variety of x-rays that can be done to neonates presenting with cyanosis. You can find diaphragmatic hernia, for example. You can face a child with situs inversus totalis, raising the possibility of complex congenital heart disease. You can find simply that this is a preterm with RGS and there is no need for further cardiac investigations. A variety of cases, you can here you can find an increased pulmonary congestion, so you can assess and get lots of information through chest x-ray. What about the ECG? Actually, ECG in the neonatal period is not of very much value. It just can help us to know if there is associated dysrhythmias or not. But regarding the ventricular enlargement, we know that all babies will be born with RV dominance. But later on in life, it can give this can give us this information about left or right ventricular enlargement. Now we come to the standard diagnostic tool, which is the echocardiography. Why I'm performing echocardiography? It is the only non-invasive tool that can give us more detailed information about the anatomy of this congenital heart defect, confirming the presence of congenital cyanotic heart disease. It gives us the physiological classification if there is pulmonary stenosis or not. It gives us a functional assessment for the ventricular function, hemodynamic information about the pulmonary artery pressure, and help us to plan the future management and repair for this child. Before we are talking about more detailed information about the variation in the congenital cyanotic heart disease, we need to refresh our mind about the fetal circulation and its transition to the normal circulation, because this is an important key player in our game to detect the congenital cyanotic heart disease. During the fetal life, we have very important structure, which is the ductus arteriosus. The ductus arteriosus helps to shift the blood from the pulmonary artery and the pulmonary circulation to the descending aorta, because the lungs are not expanding and there is no need for blood to go to the lung. It's not the source of oxygenated blood. The oxygenated blood is coming to the fetus from his mother through the IVC, which flows through the patent foramen ovale to the left atrium, to the left ventricle, to the aorta. While the blood flowing from the SVC to the right atrium directly to through the tricuspid valve to the pulmonary artery and shifts through the ductus arteriosus to the descending aorta. So why this happens? Because we have a very high pulmonary vascular resistance and a low systemic vascular resistance. So it's better and the blood is flowing preferentially through the ductus arteriosus to the descending aorta. What happens after birth? The pulmonary vascular resistance drops with the first breath the child takes, maybe on the same day or taking few days after. And the pulmonary vascular resistance increased markedly after removal of the placenta, and the ductus arteriosus started to constrict, then fibrosed and closed permanently. So if we have a congenital heart problem that is dependent on this ductus, the child will be presented as soon as this ductus is going to close. And this is the so-called duct-dependent circulation. The duct-dependent circulation could be a pulmonary duct-dependent circulation in which the pulmonary flow to the lungs depends completely on the PDA, such as cases of pulmonary atresia or tricuspid atresia. In other situations, the systemic circulation is the one dependent on the ductus arteriosus, like cases of interrupted aortic arch or severe coarctation or hypoplastic left heart syndrome. Sometimes there is a type of lesions which are the mixing lesion, in which the child has two parallel circulation and the presence of PDA helps him to get mixing between these two circulation, like what's happening in transposition of the great arteries. So these types of anomalies will present immediately when the ductus start to close. If it closes on the first day, he will present on the first day. If within a few days, he will present within a few days. To go on more details, the duct-dependent pulmonary circulation, we have several varieties. You can imagine if there is obstruction at the level of the pulmonary valve, like cases of pulmonary atresia, the whole way from the RV to the pulmonary artery is closed. So the only way to get oxygenated blood is to have blood flowing from the aorta to the pulmonary through the ductus arteriosus to the lungs and get back to the left side of the heart. So we need this ductus to maintain the life of this baby. So much similar is the critical pulmonary stenosis. If we have severe narrowing of the pulmonary stenosis, we will find that the pulmonary circulation will be completely dependent on this ductus. But there is complete difference between the prognosis of this category and the planning of both of them. We will talk about it later. Now you can see this is a case of critical pulmonary stenosis where the child has a right to left shunt on the patent foramen ovale and severely hypertrophied right ventricle. Another category is tricuspid atresia, in which we have a complete obstruction of blood flow from the right atrium to the right ventricle. So the right ventricle will not develop well during the intrauterine life. And this child, when born, he will get obligatory flow from the right atrium to the left atrium through the patent foramen ovale, then through the left atrium to the left ventricle to the aorta. So the only way to get pulmonary blood flow is through the ductus arteriosus. Otherwise, the child will not get pulmonary blood flow. The mixing lesions, which is the transposition of the great arteries. Here we got two parallel circulation. You get systemic venous blood return to the right atrium, to the right ventricle, which is giving rise to the aorta. So the deoxygenated blood will flow to the aorta going back to the rest of the body. And the oxygenated blood returning to the left atrium will flow to the left ventricle and going up to the pulmonary artery again to the lung. So we have completely parallel circulation. There must be a mixing site. This site could be through the interatrial communication, which is the PFO, or through a ventricular septal defect, or through the ductus. If the child doesn't have a VSD, so he is depending on the ductus arteriosus. What about the interatrial communication? Transposition is not just a simple entity, it is rather complex. Which means the presentation of transposition could be very different from one patient to another. The patient might have poor mixing if he has a restrictive patent form in ovale and his ductus arteriosus is closing. And this baby will present in the neonatal period as a critical baby with cyanosis and needs urgent intervention. He might get adequate mixing through a good sized ASD, or he might have a VSD, or through his PDA. Or else he may be having increased pulmonary blood flow if this mixing is through a large VSD, for example, and in this situation, he might present later beyond the neonatal period with manifestations of congestive heart failure. What about the duct-dependent systemic circulation? Actually, this group of anomalies are not presenting with the profound central cyanosis like those of duct-dependent pulmonary circulation or the mixing type of poor mixing type of TGA. But the cyanosis here most probably will be peripheral cyanosis due to low cardiac output, systemic hypotension, maybe shock and circulatory collapse. And we can face this problem with patients with severe coarctation, hypoplastic left heart syndrome, and interruption of the aorta. We are searching for clues for diagnosis. So the first question, is it cyanotic or acyanotic? Okay, you should detect cyanosis if there is clubbing in the older age. If you are in doubt before and after exercise, search for cyanosis. If it is a type of intermittent cyanosis, use the pulse oximeter. Is it associated with right or left ventricular enlargement? Where is the apex? Where the chest X-ray, the ECG? Ask about manifestations of increased or decreased pulmonary blood flow through the history and examination and using chest X-ray, and finally confirm by echo. You should reach to clues about the increased or decreased pulmonary blood flow, and there are several points in your history and examination and the chest X-ray that can help you to assess this. Congenital cyanotic heart disease should be classified either cyanosis with increased pulmonary blood flow, decreased pulmonary blood flow, normal pulmonary blood flow, or due to abnormal mixing or combination. Physiologically, we have grouped them into a group like fallot physiology, those patients have decreased pulmonary blood flow, pulmonary stenosis, and VSD. Tetralogy of Fallot presents mostly beyond the neonatal period, maybe after 1 or 2 months, sometimes later. And the most important is the presence of cyanosis, maybe cyanotic spells or squatting. Those patients have VSD, overriding aorta, and pulmonary stenosis. There are several congenital heart disease that are grouped in this category, like, for example, double outlet right ventricle with VSD, pulmonary stenosis, pulmonary atresia with VSD. If you think about the hemodynamics of each type of this category, you will find them all having the same physiology, decreased the pulmonary blood flow, a mixing lesion through VSD. The other group is the Eisenmenger physiology. There is decreased pulmonary blood flow and pulmonary hypertension. Those type of patients originally have a lesion with increased pulmonary blood flow, which caused them pulmonary vascular disease, which become irreversible, and then they got a reversed shunt, right to left shunt over their VSD or PDA or whatever site of shunt they have. So if you do them chest X-ray, you will find the periphery having less blood flow. And actually, this type of abnormality could be faced later in childhood or sometimes early, like in patients with Down syndrome. The Epstein anomaly, these type of patients have decreased pulmonary blood flow and congestive heart failure. But Epstein anomaly could present with wide variations of presentation. It could present in the neonatal period with cyanosis, later on with heart failure in infancy, or just murmur heard in childhood, or with arrhythmias in adolescents and adults. And the main problem of these patients is the apical displacement of the tricuspid valve with severe tricuspid regurg. The patients with transposition physiology, we have those with poor mixing will present in the neonatal period with cyanosis, or those with adequate mixing, and those with large VSD who will have a large increased pulmonary blood flow. And there are other anomalies that could be put in this category. Truncus arteriosus, for example, can be grouped in the category of transposition physiology with increased pulmonary blood flow, where the pulmonary artery is coming out from the aorta, so you have a single trunk giving blood to the systemic circulation and to the pulmonary. So these patients have an increased pulmonary blood flow. The other type is the total anomalous pulmonary venous return, especially if this channel returning the pulmonary venous blood is obstructed, which will cause them severe pulmonary venous hypertension. And those patients cannot survive beyond the first 1 or 2 months if they are not corrected. This is a rapid diagram about how to deal or how to think about cyanotic congenital heart disease. If you have cyanosis, you should think increased or decreased vascularity. You should think which chamber is enlarged. So how to manage these patients? There is medical and interventional management if we are dealing with a critical ill neonate. Stabilize them, get an access, intubate them, and put them on mechanical ventilation if you need, assess them properly, exclude the other differential diagnosis of neonatal cyanosis, don't forget ABC. And if you are suspecting a duct-dependent circulation, don't hesitate to start prostaglandin if the saturation is below 70%. Don't forget to correct his hypotension because you will not get him improved if it is, he is hypotensive. Prostaglandin is a life-saving drug in these conditions. It helps the ductus to be maintained open until you reach a final diagnosis and plan what you are going to do for this baby. After you stabilize and start prostaglandin if you need, think about the urgent management. Now we are talking about the urgent management in the critically ill neonates. Sometimes we can intervene with catheterization or sometimes with surgery. The role of intervention sometimes may be life-saving because you cannot refer this baby to surgery in this critical condition. So there are some procedures that we can do to stabilize and help the neonate to bypass this critical period and to get the proper planning of management. Catheterization has the advantage of being less invasive, shorter hospital stay. You can refer a critical neonate to catheterization rather than to surgery. For example, those with critical pulmonary stenosis, we can dilate their pulmonary valve with balloons and establish proper pulmonary blood flow. Those with duct-dependent pulmonary circulations, like pulmonary atresia, for example, we can maintain the PDA opened if we put stents, and we are using stents like the coronary stents. This helps us to gain much time to help the child to get his surgery later on and to be weaned from prostine. There are some angios to show you how we put these stents in these infants and establishing a proper pulmonary blood flow after opening these stents. Another intervention is the radio frequency ablation in cases with pulmonary atresia, intact septum with good sized right ventricle. We ablate the pulmonary valve and help to get a flow through it. The so famous Rashkind procedure, which is the first intervention to be done in pediatric cardiology, is to open the interatrial communication, helping those babies with transposition of the great arteries to get proper mixing through the interatrial communication. To summarize, what you need to do is, first, establish the presence of cyanosis. Second, assign the pathology. Know this child, if he the type, and through knowing the type of murmur, his chest X-ray, then assess the severity. Is he a critical patient or not? Step four, confirm the diagnosis. So the first thing to do is not an echo. The first thing to do is to stabilize your patient. The timing of intervention is changing all the time. For example, TGA is a type of anomaly that needs to be corrected during the first month of life, not later than 21 days, to do a complete arterial switch. This should be done during the first 3 weeks. If not, during this period, you can do him atrial switch. Another anomaly is the total anomalous pulmonary venous return. He needs urgent intervention. Truncus arteriosus is another anomaly which should be corrected rapidly during the first few months of life. Fallot tetralogy is one of the anomalies that can be treated around 9 to 12 months of life. The take-home message: first, stabilize your patient. It's not important to know the exact anatomy. It's important to save the life of your patient. Have a systematic approach with history, physical examination, and categorize into physiological groups. Echocardiography should be performed as early as possible. Thank you so much.